We're going to do an example now. This is, we're going to just look at domains here. And well, actually, we're going to compute g of f and f of g as well. So let's start out with the easy parts. We've done domains of functions that look like this before. What's the domain of f? Right here. Make sure this is not negative. When it'll be negative? Well, if x is 1, this will be 0. And if it's greater than 1, this will be positive. So the domain of f is going to be 1 to infinity. Domain G, just do not use negative 2. So it's negative infinity, negative 2, union, negative 2, infinity. So separately, the domains are pretty easy to compute and understand for f and g. Now we're going to look at domain of g of f. Let's also compute g of f of x. I really recommend that you use this notation. So first we're going to take the inside part. What's f of x? It's the square root. So this is g of square root x minus 1. What does g do to this? Here, right here is where the input goes. So it's going to be 1 over square root x minus 1 plus 2. In this form, if you do not simplify any further, you can get the domain right out of here. So what problems would we have to look out for here in the domain? Well, we still have a square root, so it still has the property that it must be 0 or greater, which will be taken care of right here. It's domain of f. Now, do we have to look out for anything else? So what else do we need to do? Which x values here have the property that they would make this one that would not be inside the domain of G? So what I'm going to do, which f of x values are not in domain of G? So that was right off the last page for domain of compositions. What's f of x? That's square root x minus 1. What does it mean to not be in the domain of g? Well, good news is there's only one number not in the domain of g. It's negative 2. So if you're not in the domain of g, there's only one thing not in the domain of g. That's negative 2. So how do we solve this? Well, we have a square root and a negative 2 over here. You cannot have a square root giving you negative unless you use imaginary numbers. And actually, even then, I is not negative anything. It's the square root of negative 1. So we have no solutions right here. What that means is there are no f of x is not in the domain of g. So there are no more bad x's. There's no way to get f of x into the domain of g. It would be different if this was a minus 2 here, then I would have a bad value down here. So the domain, turns out, is just domain of f. So there is domain of f of g. Now we're going, or g of f. Now we're going to look at domain of f of g. And this is g of f right here. So we computed it right there, and we got the domain. So now let's go ahead and compute f of g of x. So what is g of x? 1 over x plus 2. Now we gotta be careful. We're plugging this into where I see x up here for f of x. We can already see negative 2 is going to be bad. We'll be dividing by 0 right here. So we don't want to do that. Now we also have to make sure this whole thing is positive. So if we are very careful about that, we could figure out when is 1 over x plus 2 minus 1 greater than or equal to 0. So this will be what values we're allowed to use. And obviously negative 2 is already out. How do we solve this? We did this before. We're going to have to go common denominator, turn into a rational function, graph, and then figure out when is it positive above the x-axis. So common denominator. And let's give this function a name. We already used f and g, so we'll call this h of x. Now we can subtract these very easily. 1 minus x minus 2 minus x minus 1. And let's write that. So there we go. There's h of x. Now I'm going to very quickly graph this. We have an x-intercept, an asymptote, vertical asymptote, x equals negative 2, x-intercept, what x-value makes this 0, negative 1, y-intercept, got 1 over 2, but negative, and end behavior. Ignore the plus 1, plus 2. We have negative x over x, which is negative 1. Draw the cloud. Y equals negative 1. We're going to do a really quick graph here. Vertical asymptote, negative 2. X-intercept, negative 1. Y-intercept, negative 1 half. End behavior, y equals negative 1. Connect these two together. Now, only one way to approach horizontal asymptote. This is a cross x-intercept. This is a cross asymptote. When is this greater than 0? This is the portion of the graph, and it's okay to equal 0. So we're going to be taking this whole part of the graph. So we have negative 2 to negative 1. We cannot use negative 2. We will be using negative 1. Good news is the negative 2 we had to look out for is already not included. These domains can get tricky. I recommend you look in the examples in the book. There's a few examples. Before you simplify, if you're careful, you can see the domain. Sometimes it involves rational function inequalities.